ain't heard nothing. You want to hear good, crispy? All right, hold on. Good, crispy. Goodbye. Good, crispy. Don't cry. The little choo-choo train that takes me away from you. You don't know just how sad it makes me. Kiss me, pretty, and then.
I think the great disaster that befell the picture business was sound. See, we had a high art of pantomime at its very peak.
Don't cry, Tootsie, don't cry. Kiss me, Tootsie, goodbye.
Sound hit in such a way that the restrictions were enormous. That was the shock of the advent of sound.
The thing that made me so sad, really, was that the international language was over. We had finally come to a language which could be shown everywhere and which everyone could understand, and we were just blowing it up, and we blew it up at that point.
Goodbye, goodbye, goodbye.
When we think of silent films, we tend to think of them all like this. Jerky, flickering, a little absurd. Moving at the wrong speed with that tinkling piano. The reality was different. The silent film as its public knew it. Not a classic, just a regular release from a big studio. A film from a lost era. The silent film was never silent. In the big theaters, they had orchestras of as many as 100 players.
The music was so important, I would roughly say 40-50% of the value of the person watching and the emotion.
It's hard to describe the impact of a silent movie. You know, you'd think that this is some dead issue that's long gone, but the silent movies were so well created, so magnificently thought out. The situations were done in such a thing, there is tremendous emotional impact in these things still. Take the image of the picture, the reaction of the audience to this image, tied together with the music, and you really have a kind of a happening.
Theaters, as impressive as the films, picture palaces were built all over the world. They gave audiences far more than just a night out.
It was really an event, because you were conscious of entering a very beautiful and magic world the minute you bought your ticket and walked through that door, because they had these tremendous military organizations, ushers, servicemen, as they were here were called. They drilled these young men and all the niceties of treating people and how they would greet you when you went in and how they would act, how would they seat you to their seat, so forth. And then the unfolding of when you'd walk into that great bronze and gold dome, it was like you were walking into another world.
Another world above the clouds in this epic of the war in the air. Another world, the slave galleys of the Roman Empire. Ben-Hur was an MGM epic. One of the art directors, Arnold Gillespie.
There were 150 oars, 75 on each side, three tiers of 25 each. They were all fastened together so they could row in unison.
The galleys were built in Italian shipyards and filmed in the Mediterranean.
The Macedonians had captured a Roman soldier and had strapped him onto this boar's head, which was the ramming device in the front of the galley, and they were supposed to ram right through the big Arius's galley with this Roman soldier, of course, being torn to bits. No Roman soldier wanted to do this, regardless of how many lire we might pay him, so I remember we went to the stockyards and bought two goats and skinned them and put the flesh and the bones and the freshly blood and so on and so on, so that when the battering ram came through, there would be flesh of some kind, supposedly this poor Roman soldier.
Some silent films were even in Technicolor. Douglas Fairbanks was among the first to use it. The idea for a film about pirates was suggested to Fairbanks by Jackie Coogan, who watched the filming of the underwater scenes.
It was not done underwater at all. It was done on stage with blue backing, and the men were in mechanics, suspended. But they did the swimming movements like this, you know, and they were moved across this stage.
The silent film, pictures, and music soon became a universal language, a language understood all over the world.
In darkest Africa and middle of India and all through China, way out of the way places where nothing had ever happened, maybe places they'd never even seen a motor car, never heard of an airplane, they would still see a movie.
Nothing in this new language had more universal appeal than comedy. Laurel and Hardy had been in pictures separately for years when they were brought together in 1926 by producer Hal Roach.
Laurel and Hardy were to sell Christmas trees in the summertime, and they needed a bungalow, which they were going to practically wreck. So the location management now, which is his rule, and made three or four photographs of different bungalows, showed them to the director. The director picked one that happened to be a house that belonged to somebody working at the studio. He made a deal with this man and his wife to go on a vacation for a month, and while they were gone, we would make the picture, wreck their house, but pay him so much money for the use of the house and guarantee to put it back in the same position it was before. Picture of this house that was owned by the man at the studio. On the way to location, the director said, "This is the house," and pulled in. The crew got off, unloaded their things, and finally the assistant director said, "The key doesn't open the door, so that makes it, they're going to break it down anyway, just break the door down." Two more days to go, and a car pulled up in front of this house with a man, his wife, and two children. The wife practically fainted, and the man the same. And that was the first time we found out we were doing this at the wrong house, because the other people were on location, on their vacation.
It was a different art entirely. The silent film was an art unto itself. And I don't think that in any way, except by coincidence, it had much to do with theater or even with talking films.
When sound started, that's when popcorn began. Because they could turn away and look and talk to your girlfriend and unwrap candy bars and all that, and you wouldn't miss anything. You could hear it at the same time. In silent pictures, you couldn't eat popcorn or two drinks because you had to watch the screen all the time and you had to interpret what was going on.
A drama like The Wind, directed by Victor Seastrom and starring Lillian Gish, demanded intense concentration from the audience.
Thank you. just telling a story, painting a picture. I always saw myself as an artist. Other people take a piece of canvas and oil and watercolors and paint a picture up there that's supposed to interest or move you. And I only had my body, and I had to do the same thing. I think of all the films I ever did, physically, that was the most uncomfortable. They put 8 airplane propellers and smoke pots to create the windstorm up in Bakersfield, where it was never under 120 in the shade. I don't think film should have married words. It separates the world. Film and music brings the world together again. They all understand it.
Noah's Ark, one of the last silent films, had dialogue scenes added, but it still displayed all the spectacle which audiences of the silent era had come to expect from Hollywood. And in the silent era, Hollywood was a magnet for foreign directors, like Michael Curtiz.
He was an acrobat of some kind in one of those obscure Magyar countries between Czechoslovakia and Yugoslavia. I thought it always said they shook him out of a tree and put shoes on him and brought him to America. But he did have the greatest power of visualizing. I visualize. Booney, come here, I visualize the scene, you know. And he would give you the damnedest lineup you ever heard of. Curtiz was a very excitable guy and pretty sadistic. Would go out of control a great deal. I remember a scene that I walked over to Vitagraph lot where they were making it, and they let go with about 50 dump tanks and a big reservoir with extras in the path of this flood. Not stunt people, you know. And they came tumbling down topsy-turvy, the Curtiz screaming at them from the sidelines and throwing two befores into the flood because they started to stand up and panic.
The star of the film was Dolores Costello.
It was brutal. I called it mud, blood, and flood. It was much blood. Mr. Curtiz had been told which were the breakaways, which were the permanent parts of the set. And they had long horned steer in there, and human beings, and some dummies. But he put the human beings where the real set was, and the dummies where the breakaway was, because he wanted realism, as he called it. There were people injured. I found a man leaning against my dressing room door, which was really an office, and he was heavily bandaged. And I said, "What's wrong?" He said, 38 ambulances have left. I'm in better condition than most of them, and they're coming back for me." And he said, "I think somebody's been killed."
The public knew nothing of the making of a film like Noah's Ark. What they cared about were the glittering stars, the fabulous sets, the glamour, the escape to another world. By 1929 and the end of the silent era, Hollywood films have become the most powerful medium of mass entertainment the world has ever known. Yet it was only 15 years since the birth of the feature film, and only 20 more since moving pictures began. In the age of the horse and cart, the movies began. At amusement arcades like Tally's Phonograph Parlor, Americans saw their first moving pictures. Annabelle was filmed in 1894 and tinted by hand, frame by frame. You watched her in a slot machine made by the Edison Company. Sometimes you got music, too. The film lasted 30 seconds, moving in a continuous loop. The men who ran the arcades quickly realized what brought the customers in. Sex. The birth of a pearl. And violence. The execution of a spy. In the early 1900s, moving pictures were also shown in vaudeville houses. But by 1903, the craze seemed over when a film appeared which changed everything. The Great Train Robbery took American movies out of the slot machine era. Instead of 30 seconds, it lasted 12 minutes, nearly a whole reel. told the story in detail of the robbery of a passenger train. Some prints were carefully hand-tinted. To play a train robber, director Edwin S. Porter hired G.M. Anderson, later to become famous as the cowboy Bronco Billy.
I played about four or five parts in that. I was a fellow that run away from the passenger train after the robbers got them all lined up and got killed. Then I was a tenderfoot in the room where they were having a dance, and all the roughnecks made me dance.
Anderson was in the audience at Hammerstein's Theatre on a night in December 1903.
They were all seated there, and they came out and made an announcement. They're going to see something wonderful, a great train robbery. And the audience didn't seem to take to the idea very much, and then started. Then as it started, they all started to get boisterous and yell and shouted, "Catch them, catch them!" And after the picture was over, they all stood up and cheered and shouted, "And run it again, run it again!" It was over, they all in one acclaim gave it a rousing reception. And I said to myself then, that's it. It's going to be the picture business for me. The future has no end.
Arriving in America at the rate of a million a year was the natural audience for the moving picture, immigrants. They needed no English to enjoy moving pictures. For them, the 5-cent picture theater was a godsend. The Nickelodeon craze swept through the big cities. By 1907, there were 3,000 of them. Programs lasted between 15 minutes to an hour and changed every day. And every day, they were seen by more than 2 million people. If America had the audience, it did not have the industry. The most accomplished films had to be imported from Italy, England, and France. This, from Pathé Frères of Paris, was typical of hundreds which showed the technical superiority of European films. American films had less money spent on them, and it showed. Crude scenery, simple plots, flat lighting. Most actors were ashamed to appear in them. An actress who did work in pictures from 1910 was Viola Dana.
They called them the Flickers. And, of course, you'd never let it be known that you did the Flickers in the summertime. Just to make a few dollars.
The theater closed for the summer, but the Nickelodeons kept going. And as people lined up to see the movies, so others lined up to act in them. For unemployed actors, $5 a day was worth the risk of ridicule. Vitagraph was the largest company, turning out 200 films a year. But even they failed to attract the top stage stars.
People from the regular theater looked down upon you for making motion pictures. They thought the stage was superior to films. And it was for a while. Let's face it, it was.
In France, Sarah Bernhardt, the world's greatest actress, made a four-reel film. It attracted her admirers all over the world and led to a series of famous players in famous plays. Others were convinced that merely photographing stage plays was not enough. The man who who sensed the extraordinary potential of the moving picture was D.W. Griffith, a director for the American Biograph Company. He turned out so many pictures, over 80 a year, that he could afford to experiment. Griffith and his cameraman, Billy Bitzer, transform a close-up into an expression of menace in this gangster film. By aiming a gun directly at the audience, he makes them share the terror of Dorothy and Lillian Gish, two young actresses discovered for Biograph by Griffith.
He was the father of film. He didn't do everything the first time like a close-up, but he developed, he gave us the grammar of filmmaking, the cutting.
A girl telegraphist has been kidnapped by bandits. Will the train get there in time? The race to the rescue was already a Griffith trademark.
The one that we wanted to please. He was the one that, if he would come over after a scene was over and say, that was good, that was good. That's all you needed. That's really, I mean, if you just a small salary and his, that's good.
Griffith now led the most influential production team in the business.
Everybody copied the Biograph. If word got out that we were doing a story of some sort, other people would hear of it and then try and duplicate that, get it out before we would.
The rival companies strove to outdo Biograph. SNA, Lubin, Edison, Vitagraph, Rex, and many more.
We weren't the only people that were making strides ahead. You know, everything is being attributed to Griffith as making the technique of films. Well, he did. But also there were others, you know.
Lois Weber directed and played the lead in this one real melodrama. Alone in the house, she is threatened by an intruder. As well as intercutting, like Griffith, Weber showed three incidents happening at the same time with a split screen, a remarkable innovation for 1913. Some of her other ideas were Griffith's, taken one stage further. However skilled the Americans, the Europeans produced pictures on a far grander scale. Quo Vadis, an eight reel Italian epic, showed Nero and the burning of Rome and lasted nearly 2 hours longer than American one reelers. D.W. Griffith was determined to challenge the Italians. In Instead of rushing out a film a week, Griffith now devoted his time to a single production. Judith of Bethulia was made on location at Chatsworth in California. The title role was played by Blanche Sweet.
It's the first time he ever talked to me of making a film. Before that, it had always been rehearsing whatever it was and doing it, you see. And we talked doing Judith. Oh, I would say several months before we ever made it. Of course, there was a lot to be talked about because there was the money in the first place.
The industry was doing well with one and two reelers. Why risk a four-reel film which people might not sit through? Asked Biograph. Biograph and Griffith quarreled. Griffith decided to leave, taking most of the company with him.
So, after he left, he started planning, I believe, something that he'd had in mind for years, the story of the Civil War, since his father was a colonel in that war, and he grew up listening to stories about it.
Griffith found his story in the Reverend Thomas Dixon's The Klansman, a favorite stage melodrama. He posed with Civil War veterans to give the film an air of authenticity. He rented a tract of land near Burbank, north of Hollywood, for the battle scene, and ordered trenches and earthworks to be dug. Cameraman Billy Bitzer filmed this shot of the site as a test. Griffith also made tests of Lillian Gish and the other leading players in costume. Costumes, sets, weapons forced the budget far beyond anything yet spent on an American film.
All of us in the company were asked to do without salary, as we had to pay extras, the people that got $5 a day that weren't part of the company, and all of us said, of course we'll wait.
I don't think that Griffith ever saw the day when he was solvent. We used to bail him out. He used to come down to the city room of the paper that I worked on at that time, the Los Angeles Herald, and we'd pass the hat, take up a collection and give it to him, say, now go, and he'd go on out to his people and pay them their salary out of that.
Griffith's crew had little idea of what they would end up with. Assistant cameraman Carl Brown thought it was just another melodrama. The opening night at Clune's Auditorium changed his mind.
I saw that first night without any inkling of what was coming up. But I sat and watched players come in until the entire orchestra pit was fitted. And I didn't realize until that time that the entire Los Angeles Philharmonic Orchestra had been hired to play the picture. An unheard of thing. So in came Joe Breel, who had written the score. And when he raised his baton and held it for a moment, and down it came, everything just blew right out of the Oh, it was the most tremendous gust of sound I'd ever heard.
There'd been feature films before, but never one so sweeping and dramatic. President Wilson said it was like seeing history by flashes of lightning. Griffith changed the title from The Klansman to The Birth of a Nation.
And I sat at the end of a row with men. And during parts of that, the whole row shook with their sobs. It was so moving.
Griffith touched the audience's heart because the story was so close to his own. The South was defeated just a decade before he was born.
Oh, I suppose it began when I was a child. I used to get under the table and listen to my father and his friends talk about the battles they'd been through and their struggles. And those things impress you deeply. And I suppose that got into the birth. Well, that's natural enough, you know, and you've heard your father tell about fighting day after day, night after night, and having nothing to eat but parched corn. People were fighting desperately against great odds, great sacrifices, suffering, death. It was a great struggle, a great story.
But it was a bitter story. A story of defeat from the viewpoint of the defeated white South. The Negro, suddenly freed from slavery, had been given equal rights. And Griffith, a Southerner, mocked these new politicians in this caricature of the South Carolina Assembly.
Of course, you have to take Griffith and his Southern background seriously because it's a very important part of the man. You couldn't have been brought up with all that background of the South without it coloring your feelings. I don't wonder that they have called Griffith a racist.
Griffith invented episodes in which white actors dressed as blacks behaved like monsters, pure melodrama. Yet audiences believed his fiction was fact.
Mr. Griffith loved the black people. We never thought there was anything against the blacks. As you notice, the blacks are led by a white man who was patterned after Thaddeus Stevens, a senator, who said to the black people, "We will crush the white South under the heels of the black South."
Somebody mentioned that if he ever showed a picture like this in Atlanta, the result would be race riots, to which Griffith said, "I hope to God they do." It wasn't that he was particularly anxious for a riot or people to be hurt or anything of the sort, but it's the old story of somebody deals you a tremendous pat hand and you look at it and know it can't lose, you're going to play it.
Of the film were the Ku Klux Klan riding to the rescue.
It was like a call to arms. You just couldn't let go. You weren't watching people ride, you were riding with them. And you weren't riding with them to rescue somebody, but you were riding on a stern determination of vengeance, vengeance.
We'll be right back.
Revolution created a racist problem in the United States that exploded and caused any number of theaters to cancel the film.
Demonstrators took to the streets. The Negroes were appalled. They saw the film as renewing all the old fears and hatred. They saw that by glorifying the Klan, Griffith's film could bring about its revival, which is exactly what happened. Soon after The Birth of a Nation was released, the Ku Klux Klan was reborn.
The showing of the Klansmen started riots and put blood on the streets was proof beyond proof that it was a great and powerful picture, regardless of what any critic might have to say about it. The proof was there.
The motion picture was now taken seriously. Even at $2 a seat, middle-class Americans went in huge numbers.
They lost track of the money it was making. But it started all the fortunes of Louis B. Mayer and all the people in films.
With one film, Griffith had transformed the industry. More than anyone before him, he revealed the power of the motion picture camera.
Nothing like it in this century has ever been seen. Of course, it's a machine, but so is an automobile, so is a plane, but no other machine touches the mind and hearts of men and women as the camera can.